Hello everyone, how are you today? So today we will move into chapter number 5, Basics of PLC. Before we start, we will go through maybe the planning of the course, okay? How we have gone through so far and what is next, right? So here we are at the week number 8 today, and as we can see, we still have another half 7 weeks to go. Okay, from that, we, as I have shown here, okay, our week 10 and week 11 will coincidence with a public holiday, right, which fall on Fridays, okay, or both of this, okay. So therefore, since we are quite ahead of time, then that's something good that we can actually let it be, okay. So on these 2 weeks, we will have a free time, okay. And during that time, since I will give you some lab work, okay, on the 18th, then you may try to complete it, okay. Then we will resume on 8th of January, right? So here is week 8, then next week is a midterm break, and we will follow with another week before we have this so-called long break, okay, in between, okay, before we continue again, right? So for this course, since we don't have a final exam, we will replace that final exam with a test, okay. And I have tentatively set the test to be on 15 and 22, okay. That would be before your study week and other final exams, okay. Hopefully things will go as planned, right, and the topics are given as such, right. Okay, so move back to this to the topic of today, right. So today is about the basic of PLC, where we will try to see what are the components in PLC, okay, so that we will be able to understand and develop a simple PLC program in the later stage, okay. So today we will mainly focus on introducing what are the PLC components, okay, before we move on to the programming part next week, the next lessons, right. So just a recap on some of the items that we have learned before, right. So as we can see that we need hardware, right, the actuators and so on to do the hard work, okay. Then also we have those hardware that's involved in the sensing, okay, as a sensor, okay. And here we need a computational units, the brain, to connect them, okay, to control the input, okay, from the sensors as well as the output to the sense to the actuator, okay. So here is where the PLC or the programs come into play. And this brain itself, also the brain itself, is a kind of hardware, okay. And the contained inside the brain is the program, right, that you are going to deal with later on, right. So I believe you have seen these slides before, okay, where I told you about the PLC. Then you can actually see the difference between PLC and microcontroller as well as microprocessor, right. So basically PLC and microcontroller are very very similar in some sense, okay. Only the way they package it may be slightly different, and as the package of the hardware are more orientated to the industry use, okay, to connect different kind of sensors and actuators in the industry, then they may somehow call that as PLC sort of, right. So that there is a blur line in between, whereas the microcontroller may be a more general terms, okay, that would be used okay, in other field. But then you would see some of this microcontroller actually being used in PLCs as well, okay, especially nowadays, okay, with the development of the microcontrollers and microprocessors, okay, the boundary line between them are getting closer. So here is a PLC, okay. PLC stands for Programmable Logic Controllers, okay. The functions of it is to act as a digital device, okay, the hardware of the brain, okay, which contain microcontrollers and a programmable memories, okay. So you have a memory, you have a processing part, okay, that can store and execute the instructions, okay, such as Boolean logics, timing, okay, counting, and other mathematical processings. Okay. The purpose for sure is to control operations of complex machines, okay. We would expect to do that, okay, multiple machines maybe, okay, or an overall industry process, okay, that is that would involve multiple machines, okay, through the utilizations of the digitals as well as the analog input output, right? So I believe you have learned this through the microprocessors courses as well, okay, where you have seen Arduino boards with the digital and analog input output side, right? So it's very similar, okay. In fact, nowadays there are PLCs that can be programmed through the Arduino IDE, right? So the lines between this so-called industry hardware and the micro controller are getting closer and closer as the technology advance, okay. So the previous technology that specialized for industry now are getting into the common ground, right? So that's why it's become more common nowadays, and the programming part as well will get through different stage of society as well, okay. So different hobbies and so on, we'll be able to do the programming, okay. And hopefully maybe when it's long enough, okay, then the new programming language or software may start to take over the PLC, okay. But for time being, because as I've mentioned previously, because of the history of PLC that have been implemented in the industry for very long time, to replace them, okay, especially with the human resources or the skilled professionals that exist in the industry, would take some time, right? Here we can see that this is a so-called compact type of PLC, okay, where we call this as CPU units, okay, that do most of the computational things, okay, with several input and output terminal, right? Then they can also being extendable, we call it the expansions IO unit, okay. IO means input output, right? So you can always extend it, right? So again, you can see that why PLC have become very popular in the industry is that PLC actually contain the various type of functions, okay, that can replace so-called relay, timer, counter, okay. Imagine if you previously you have designed the automation circuit that involve all this timer, counter and so on, which involve hardware, right? So if we can do it in the software side, okay, in the PLC side itself, then it will save us a lot of trouble, especially in the wiring and troubleshooting it in the later stage, okay. That's why PLC have become very handy, okay, especially in the industry, okay, that's relay that relies a lot on the relays, timer, counter and so on, okay. You can see from these pictures, okay, that previously you may have a various control of timer, counters and so on through the relays, okay, the communications part, okay, that can be actually replaced, okay, in a single PLC itself, okay, through a programming. Okay, so PLCs, as you can see, the significant difference between PLC and a PC, okay, a personal computer nowadays, again, the line is getting closer and closer, okay, but still PLC are very handy in industry because of the availability of the input output for hardware, right? So you can see all those terminals are readily connected, okay? So you, if in the PC side, you may depends on various port like RS 232, USB and so on, okay? Only recent years they start to converge into USB-C and so on, okay? But then in the industry sites, okay, most of the hardware that you are going to connect, the limit switch and so on, is only two terminal, in positive, negative and so on. So they still depends or relies a lot on all these terminals input output sites, right? So the ability of this input output for hardware in the PLC are the main strength, okay, of the PLC as compared to the PC, right? Then also the operational side, okay, the operations in microcontroller operations and ability to actually interact with all these terminal positive negative are again the handy part of the PLC that's designed with the mind of the industry, right? So that's why it's still very convenient for people in the manufacturing line, okay, that's adopt a PLC, okay, they just do a wiring positive negative, okay, to the terminal, that's it, right? So you can see that the input through the logic of the PLC, then you can control the output, okay? You don't have to think of the hardware, the firmware and other things, okay, that you usually deal with it with the PC, right? But then for sure, if you want to now do so-called more complex tasks, okay, you want to do it's like a very complex calculations, you want to display, you want to communicate between one person with another person, okay, then the internet and others monitoring visualizations through monitors and so on, then PC would be required, right? So that's why again PLC have a part where you can always connect to PC as well through maybe Ethernet, through RS232 cables, and also in today's technology you can rely on fiber optic as well, okay? So all these selections of hardware, we may not go into the detail, okay, we will let that task to the right full engineers to deal with, okay, especially with the selections of the type of communications, okay, you may have communication engineers to really select and propose for you, right? So that is the task, like if the distance between two PLCs are very long, okay, it may go through several kilometers or hundreds of kilometers, okay, then you may want to adopt different kind of wiring, okay, that connect these two, okay, to ensure that the communications signal between these devices are not lost, okay, in between, right? So we will not touch on that, right? Okay, so here just an overview of the PLC, okay. Generally a PLC internally they consist of the CPU, the input output modules, okay, RAMs, as well as a power supply, okay? So you can imagine that they have all these four basic blocks inside, right? To power, to receive signal, to process it, and to store, right? So four main tasks inside it, okay? The advantages of using the PLC in the industrial automation's purposes, okay, or applications includes adequacies of the contact. You can see various type of terminals available for you, right? That's especially with the when come to the programming side, okay, internally you can actually create a lot of timer, counter, okay, that in the hardware doesn't exist, okay? If you are playing with the hardware side, okay, then you have a lot of all this hardware, right? But then that would limit your selection. But then within the PLC environment itself, okay, assuming the PLC have enough memory, okay, again, this is something that you may take into account later on, right? Generally, you have unlimited choice, okay, of contact internally. Okay, you can select maybe 100 of relay, 20 of timer counters, okay, packed inside the program itself. Okay, so that is where the PLC plays a very handy rules, okay, to make a very complex calculations. Okay, then also it would be a time saving, okay, in the sense that you can actually develop the program as well as you install the PLC and the device parallelly. Okay, if you are doing the hardware side, then you have to install it, you have to pull the wiring, okay, then only you can do the testing. Okay, but with the PLC, okay, you can actually do all these things at the same time, okay, and test it, okay, one part by one after another, okay. Then also you can reduce the space, okay, because of all the numbers of the auxiliary equipments that you can save inside the PLC. And then the ease of automations modifications that you can change directly, okay, without changing the wiring. Okay, internally you change the wiring in your program, okay, but externally nothing changed. Okay, your terminal still remain the same. Okay, the ease of the modification itself. Then also because it is a so-called software based, okay, then you can implement a lot of indicator of fault detections algorithms inside your PLC, okay, that helps you to actually detect the fault. Okay, you can check the status of every single element instead of if in the hardware you may have to wire it through LEDs and so on, right? But if it is within the PLC itself, then you can actually visualize it, okay, easily, right, through all these things. Then finally, as the modern tools evolve, okay, then PLCs become general, okay, that you can conduct and simulate, okay, with various tools. As in fact, MATLAB, they also trying to get into the way of PLC, okay, to do all these simulations. Right. Here, we can see that the automation circuits that we have learned previously might be involving various hardware, okay, but then now we can start to convert it into a PLC program, okay. So in terms of wiring now, okay, all these wirings are becoming your program, okay. So the wiring part become your programming part, okay. So this is the changes from the automation circuit to the PLC, okay. But then for sure the automation circuit still require, okay, to indicate the necessity of the operations of your automations, okay, before you can translate it into the PLC program, right? So you have to have this idea of the automation circuit, how they are connected, before you select, okay, how you can convert it into the program itself. So on the PLC, there are specific sequence and operations of actions, okay. The sequence are cyclic, okay, and continuously repeat when you start to run it, okay. So you would see these operations actually similar behavior with the Arduino board that you are or the Arduino chip that you are playing with, okay. So they will keep looping, okay. Once you start it, okay, they will keep looping. First they will scan the input, then execute the program one line after the other, then update the output again and cycle it. So this is a cycle. So they don't have like a so-called stop point, okay? You keep scanning the input, execute output, okay, and so on, right? So this is the PLC way of doing it, okay? That's why some of the PLC nowadays, they already started to support the Arduino programming, right? Because the idea are very similar, okay? So the time for a full scan, okay, for a full scan itself indicate the operational speed of the PLC. Usually it is in a millisecond, okay? So the operation, how fast it can scan all the inputs, okay, and execute it and so on, right? So that would be, we call it as scanning time, right? So if the variations of the input state is faster than the scanning time, okay, then these variations are not detectable from the PLC, okay? This is where the selections of the PLC type, the CPU type, are important, okay? When you deal with a very fast type of input, okay, if the things like sensing that require microsecond, okay, but your PLC scanning time is millisecond, then it will miss a lot of data that your sensor have detected, okay? They will miss all these things, then they only scan one signal, okay, instead of maybe 100 signal that the sensor are actually producing, okay? So in that case, let's say you are scanning a drop of a ball, okay, which happens very fast, okay, it happens in microseconds, but then your scanning time is maybe 1 second. So 1 second, the ball already dropped to the end, and you scan nothing, okay? The PLC will assume that nothing changed, okay? The ball already passed through, okay? But you scan nothing. That is where the scanning time will play a role in that sense, okay? So here you can see the automation circuit, okay? Very simple automation circuit, okay? When we try to translate it into the PLC program, okay? Here you will start to see this very similar circuit, okay? You can see very similar circuit, just the automation circuit, you just orientate it, then you have the so-called ladder diagram circuit, okay? Again, you have two lines, okay? In the automation circuits, you have the R and the neutral, okay? The rated voltage and the neutral, okay? In between, remember, we always have only one single vertical line or horizontal line to represent every single operations, okay? Whereas in the programming of the PLC, which mainly depends on the ladder diagram, okay, for very long time, okay, then again the idea is still you have two lines, okay, from one side to the other, right? So in between you may have a lot of input and as well as the output, right? So your PLCs, what you can see is that you have one switch, okay, and that switch you just connect to the input side of the PLC, right? So you need the R and the N, okay, just connect it in this way, okay, to grab the signal from the switch itself, okay? Then on the output side, okay, you can see that the output is maybe a motor or a coil, all right, represented by the C. And from the output side, you just connect your output, okay, to the output signal of your PLC, okay, similar to this way, okay? Again, you have the R and N, okay? So in between the wiring, you just have to distinguish the input side and the output side, separate them and then connect. And whatever wiring internally, you will do that through the programming, right? So that is the changes, okay, in converting the automation circuit into the PLC, right? Just quick ideas here, okay, before we move on, okay? So this is we call it as a ladder diagram, okay? A user program in a graphical form, okay? Where these symbols now, okay, would represent input, okay? Whereas this symbol, okay, represent the output, that's it, okay? So this is just a quick idea before we move to the programming side in the next sessions. Okay, so next we will look at the input-output component of an PLC, okay? Generally, all of them require a power source, okay? And they would carry the necessary circuit, okay, to convert the signal, okay, the input-output signal as well as the communications to your PLC, okay? So your PLC may want to only receive a 12-watt kind of signal. Then if your signal is very low, then you may need a circuit to amplify it and put it in. Or maybe if your signal is in a PWM type, okay, then you want to convert it into a digital form, okay, before you send it to your PLC. So you may need some kind of electronic circuit to connect them, okay? But most of the time when you are getting those so-called hardware like sensors that are readily built for PLC, the wiring and the electronic circuit parts, usually they are already pre-built, okay? You just have the wiring connected directly to the PLC, okay? Then also the PLC side, as I've mentioned, there are a lot of terminal blocks, okay, for the cable connections. Then for the input-output modules, okay, generally a most common part would be the digital input-output, okay. You have digital input, digital output, as well as the analog input-output, okay, the other two parts. So these four would be the main input-output module that available in a PLC, okay. For sure there are also a special purpose type of module, okay, like the fast scanning type and so on, right? That we may go through briefly later on. Okay, so here is the PLC input output component. Okay, so the first one would be the digital input module. Okay, so you can see that as we were to convert the input type, okay, to the PLC, what you need is to identify the input device, okay, then you connect it directly to your PLC, okay. But then for sure, because of this signal is a signal, okay, you need it to be so-called closed, right? So you may have to close the circuit by, you have a the R and N, let's say, okay. So you have to connect it, okay, to your input, and inside your input there is a common terminal, okay, that you connect to the neutral line, right? So the whenever you touch it, then the signal will go through and your PLC will now detect, okay, there is a input, okay, on state, okay, of your circuit, right? So that would be your digital input module. To receive a discrete type of signal from the input device, okay, usually maybe 12 watt, 24 watts, okay, and so on, right? It can be either continuous or alternating, okay, but then the continuous part would be just a straight line, or the alternating maybe in this digital form of alternating form, right? Because the digital input will just detect there is a cutoff signal, okay, maybe more than certain voltage, they will consider that as one, less than that would be considered zero, okay. So you can give this kind of signal, okay, in either form, right? So each digital input modules are characterized by the operating voltage, okay, the type of voltage that you are going to input to it, right? So usually there would be 24 watts, okay, usually, okay, but then they are also 24 watts, 48, 110, okay, 230, okay, depends on the environment, okay. So 110 usually used in US and Japan, right? Whereas other country, you may, Commonwealth country may use 230, okay? So you can directly connect, okay, with, without any so-called a transformer to transform, right? May, okay, you may want to do that, okay? So this kind of signal would be useful when you want to detect whether a motor is operating or not, okay? Whether you have given us a kind of voltages, okay, to operate maybe a light, okay, which operate at the 230 watts and so on, right? So all these modules are usually packed in a group, okay, of 4, 6, 8, 10, 16, 32, okay? So you have a group of it, right? Numbers of input terminal, okay? And the typical input in the form of digital would be your limit switch, okay? You just click on, off, okay? Buttons, photoelectric switch, and so on, okay? So here is an examples of a digital input module, okay, with DC type of supply, okay, in a group of four. So you can see four groups of terminal with one common, okay, four group of again input with a common, okay. So each of this group we can call that as a non-isolated input, okay. They are connected together, okay, not separate, one input with one common up neutral line, okay? So they are grouping in the form together, right? Then next would be the digital output, okay? The operations are very similar to the digital input, okay? The only difference is that it is in the reverse way, okay? They don't sense it, okay? When you do the scanning, they scan and take the input, okay, for your operations of PLC. Whereas for the output side, they now send the signal out, okay? When you going to send the signal out, then again, we need a two type of voltage, okay, to send it, two lines, okay? One is neutral and one is your rated current, and you will send it out, okay, through your PLC to your device itself, okay. So generally the current that they support would be 1 or 2 amp, okay, for each of the output terminal, okay. If you want to have more, then you may need to further add a circuit, okay, to amplify and do other switching, okay, to power it up, right? Generally it would be sufficient, okay, since this is a digital, okay, you may not want a very high ampage. It change states at the regular interval of the scan cycle, okay. So if you want it to change very fast, again it depends on the scan time, okay. If the scan time, the PLC type you are using is maybe the scan frequency, let's say the cycle is 500 millisecond, okay. 500 millisecond means 0.5 second, okay. So if you want to change state, okay, at your output, so you will only change every single half a second, okay. You cannot get faster than that, okay. So that is the way they calculate the output device, okay. So each of this output state will remain unchanged during that in between the two scan. We call that as that time between the two scan itself, okay. Again, typical output would be your relay, solenoids, alarm, etc. Okay, similar constructions, okay, input as well as output digitally, you can group into a group of 4, 6 and so on, right? Next would be the technical digital input output module, okay. So here is the technical part of it, okay. There is a nominal operation voltage that you may want to deal with, then you may also want to specify the number of input or output per module, then type of switching components that you would want to connect them, right? There are also the nominal current, okay, maybe 1 amp, 2 amp, or what are they, okay, the maximum value that you want the output can hold, okay, during the operations, okay. And lastly, whether you want the input output to have a optical isolations, okay. So if you are looking at this optical isolations, you may saw this opto isolator what's there, okay, in the circuit, right? So these are the typical specifications or technical spec that you may want to specify when you are looking to purchase or select one of it, right? Then move on to the analog side. Okay, on the analog side, again you have the input and output. Okay, on the analog input module, they are generally equipped with a signal adapting block. Okay, to transform the input in the form of analog into a digital form. Okay, we transform it into a digital form. Right? So internally there is a ADC, okay, the analog to digital converter, okay, internally inside the PLC itself, okay. So that's why even though they say they can take in the form of analog, so what happens is that once you tap in the analog signal, the PLC will do these conversions, okay, into a digital form, and they will store it or keep the digital form in the form of digital value and transfer it to the memory, okay, so that they can do this digital operations just like your computer. Okay, so many alterations, okay, it may consist of alterations of the signal adapting block by using this type of dip switch. Okay, you may want to modify the kind of signal that you would want to transform, okay, so you may use this kind of dips. Okay, so here is the typical analog input device, okay, like temperature, pressure, okay, flows, all these are in the form of continuous, okay. You don't have 37 degrees Celsius, okay, then suddenly jump to 40, okay. There is a continuous fluctuation between, and you may want to represent that okay. Based on the input device, you may have this kind of signal on it, okay, and would be represented by maybe ampere or wattage, okay, in this form, right? So here is the conversion part that mainly exists in this analog input module. Okay, on the accuracy of the conversions now, okay, internally you may need it depends, okay. It may consist of 8-bit converter, 10-bit converter, and so on, right? So what the 8-bit converter means is if you are dealing with 8-bit, okay, then it would be 2^8, okay. So 2^8, you will get 256 step, I would say, okay, or different values, okay, in between minimum and maximum, okay. So you can just spread it over by dividing your range of minimum and maximum value, okay, by 256, okay. So you will get this kind of a step, okay, to your full scale. Whereas for a 10-bit, then you can have a 2^10, okay, you get 1024, okay, of digital values. Okay, so how they would now being applied, right? So if, for example, an analog input are varying between 0 to 10 plus 10 watts, okay, only positive side, okay, then the step of accuracy for 8-bit and 10-bit would be 39.1 milliwatt per every single increment or decrement, okay? And for 10-bit, it would be 9.76 milliwatt, okay? So every time if you choose wattage, then they will actually detect this kind of wattage. And also when you convert it back, then they will output this kind of wattage, right? To your devices or from your devices, okay? So every time, these are the accuracy or the step that they will be able to detect, right? Okay, even if the digital words can have a length of 16-bit, okay, usually we would only take maybe 10 bits or 11 bits, okay? So only 11 bits are utilized for the digital part, okay, to present the signal, okay, while the rest would be used for other informations, okay? Because we would also want to know whether, for example, the sign itself, okay, you may have positive, negative, okay, so you may designate one bit for to store that, okay, whether it's positive or negative, okay. Then also you may also want to know whether the signal is zero or actually there is no connections, okay, so existing or fault, whether the wire have been cut or not, okay. So you may add all these extra bits, okay, to signify the whole range of your signal, okay, that being input to your computer, okay. So here is the form of the analog signal, okay, through the ADC, okay, then it will become, depends on the number of bit, then it will become your digital code, okay, in the 8-bit or 10 bits, okay. Then you can use it to represent your different type of input or output of wattage or ampere. Okay, so here is the similar output way, output side, the analog output module, when the digital word itself you can represent from D0 to D7, okay, that would be the conversions from the DAC now, okay, digital to analog converter, okay, very similar, but only in the reverse form, okay. The type of accuracies still within the same operational way, okay, of the input, just like the 8-bit or 10-bits or whatever it is, okay. So it depends on the other side, okay. So piecewise, constant output analog, when we output it, okay, we would usually amplify it, right? We would usually amplify it, okay, so that it reach the amount of values that you may want, okay. Internally you may want to process, okay, in the simple way, but then when you output, you may want to amplify it, as well as you may want to smoothen it through a filter, right? So this filter may act like because of the stepwise of the stepwise form of your curve, okay, of your analog output, so the filter will actually do the smoothing, okay, so that you, when you really output it, okay, the kind of signal being sent out is in a continuous form instead of a discrete stepwise form, okay, of output, okay. So here is a general connections, okay, that you may see, okay. Here is a four wire connection type, okay, four wire connection type, okay, for better accuracy, okay. So you have 1, 2, 3 as well as then the fourth one, okay, V+V, okay, over here, okay, to connect to your motor, okay, to actually signify a different kind of signal, to measure it, to get the feedback, okay. This would perform so-called a feedback loop, okay, they will detect whether the signal being sent out is actually matched or not, then they will do the kind of improvement, okay, corrections of the signal, okay, when they send it out. So that would be handled internally inside the analog output module itself, okay. So that would be produce a better accuracy. For other type of input output modules, they are fast input response module. As we have mentioned previously at the beginning, sometimes you may want to detect the kind of operations at the very high speed, okay, then you may need the fast input response module. Next would be the stepper motor control module. Okay, since stepper motor are very common type of technology being utilized, okay, especially in the applications of micro positionings of the object, okay, therefore to control it through this bit, okay, you may just add this kind of a specialized stepper motor module, okay, then if you then the signal being output to this module, they will convert it and control the stepper motor directly, okay. So the control or the programming would be very simple in that sense, okay. Then also PID, okay, the proportional integrator and derivative control module, which have been the three terms control type, okay, that have been implemented in the industry, okay, are also available, okay. You can just set what is the P, what is the I, what is the D, okay, then you will run, okay. So this is where your control knowledge, okay, that you have learned previously through the design, okay, you can get all this gain value and so on. You just implement it directly to control your device, okay, at the output side. Then lastly, for sure, you may also want to communicate with different PLC or maybe monitors or PC or PC with the world, okay, through the internet and so on. Especially when today's we talk about the IoT, okay, connected to the internet. So all this would include all these modules. So PLC also, when we move on to the IR 4.0 and so on, okay, so they will connect they already developed this kind of communication module, okay, that you can connect to the internet, okay, through fiber or ethernet, okay, and then they will stream to the server, okay, so that everyone can actually grab data or observe the data or visualize the data online, right? So this is how the PLCs keep surviving, okay, with the change of the development of the digital world, right? So you have this communication module as well. PLC are very expandable, okay. You can always connect more than one expansion IO unit, right? So there are several way to connect them, okay. So here is some idea of how you may want to connect, okay. Just a brief idea of to connect a remote input output device in a PLC. For example, you have two plants separated by a car park, okay, a large car park in your factory, okay, then you can actually do this through a power line, okay, or if you don't want to use power line, okay, then you can also use a different kind of communication cable, your network cable, okay, and so on. So if you are going to use all this network cable, then you need a processor, okay, a communication processor to process this kind of signal and interpret the signal at the end of the two side itself, right? So you may have a power power line or the communication line, okay, to actually connect them, okay, through a very long distance. Okay, then they are also we may want to categorize them depending on the distance. Okay, not really distance, but the operations itself. Okay, usually the operation itself lies within very close distance. Okay, so you may want to have a local IO extensions as well as a periphery IO extensions. Okay, so in the local extensions, it may in the form of 20 to 50 meter. Okay, maybe you have a monitoring room. Okay, monitoring and operations or machines nearby. Okay, so you may connect and use those as a local IO extensions. Okay, whereas when you want to connect one part of the operation with another, which may be now getting further away, then you may have this peripherals IO extensions. Okay, that you can either connect it through series, okay, one after another, okay, one sections to another sections and so on, or you can do it in a parallel, or we call it a star topology, right? So everything connect them together. So all this the way of doing all these connections, okay, we just get the idea and that's it. All right, so the work of this, we will let the networking expert, okay, communication expert engineers to deal with it, right? So now come to our maybe our role, all right, as a mechanical engineer somehow in a plant. Okay, so here is the plant. When if you are going to set up a plant, okay, then you may want to add in all this input output. So your role as an engineer, usually if you do the real work in the industry, okay, many time, okay, it's not really doing the calculation, the design, the integral or derivative. It's more on the counting. Okay, you counting one number, two number. Okay, so this is where you are, our role is to check, okay, whether the quantity being proposed by other side, okay, of your partner, okay, whether it's correct or not. Okay, though, so this is where you as a mechanical engineer, okay, you may play a role in it, okay, to at least know, okay, how it works, okay, so that you will not being cheated by your so-called partner, okay, in the other company, because other company they may propose things that may be beyond what you may need. Okay, so this is where you can cross check, right? So first thing in the IO system design, okay, first step, you may want to identify the number of the input output device, okay, and group them based on the operations. Okay, so here is your operations. Okay, so let's say you have these operations in the first department, the basic productions, then we have the second department on the product processing, and the last part would be the packaging, right? So we will locate the PLC locations at the first department over here. And what you need to do is you need to get the list of the input and output device, okay, for every single department. Okay, so this is the first thing that you may need to do. Okay, so all these things also if you are asking some other company to design for you, they may also request all this information for you, because the plan is yours, okay, and you have to supply all this all this information for them before they can actually design for you. Otherwise, unless you are having a empty empty plant, okay, they design from sketch, okay, they connect or communicate with the hardware engineers from different manufacturer, then fine, okay, then your role will be not you may not play any role on that, okay. But then when you start to design certain machine or you integrate certain machines, then all these things you may want to they may want all this information from you, okay. You may need to know how many motors are involved, okay, buttons, okay, what kind of operations that you as a client or you as an engineer you want, okay, the stop button or whatever it is, right? So once you have all the list of the equipment, next would be you have to group them now, okay, by separating them into department, okay. Then you will now start to if you are going to get some rough idea, you may want to check what is the capacity of the PLC, okay, such as the number of RAM, okay, local expansions, peripheral expansions that they can support and so on, right? So this step three would be just an extra step, okay, for you, okay, to counter check their work, right? That's it, okay. But the main thing is you have to group them into all the device into group, okay. Then next would be you further summarize or put into a table in the form of now you start to count, okay. You group them in the form of this would be the step three, okay, the CPU type, okay, that you may get directly from a manufacturer, okay, or your distributor. So this one I grab it from a funnels, okay. So you can always search for the product specifications, okay, and you can see a list of what are the input and output that they can support, okay, now how many points and so on. Then you can specify the modules number, right? So once you have the list of or you have the group of devices, okay, now you have to start to classify them, okay. How many of them are digital, how many of them are analog, okay, how many of them are input output, and what are their nominal operating voltage, 230 watt, 24 watt, or others, okay. So you have to start to do all these manual calculations, okay, no manual counting, okay. You have to see, okay, spec number one motor, this motor support 415 watt, okay, three phase motor, okay. You do counting now, okay, but for sure even the list grow to 200, you can still do the counting very fast, okay. Only you may do few hours, okay, but still work is still work, okay. You still can put into table, right? So once you do the counting, okay, so you may see this kind of you may put in a table, okay, so that you can see that for every single department itself, okay, every single department, then you will know the digital output that using 230 watt, okay, then you will know how many of it, okay. You just list it out, okay, so that you will get the total number, right? Then the digital input, okay, 230 watt, okay, how many is button and so on, okay, then the total of it, okay. So just have to do all this manual counting, okay, use drawing lines, okay, cut it off line, cut it off, okay. So this counting is important, okay, so that at the end of the day when you select your PLC module, you select it correctly, or else if you miscount, then when you select it at the end, you somehow do not have the extra terminal to connect, okay. So this is where you need to be careful, okay. So just double check with your counting carefully. So once you have counted all the quantities and the required input output, okay, so next is you need to actually match them, right? So match them in the sense of selecting the modules now, right? So here is the the table of the module, okay, that you may have, right? So this this is the module, let's say from the PLC specification, that you may have 16 digital output 230, okay? You have also a module of 16 digital input 230 and so on, okay? So you can list out all the modules that you may want to use, okay? Usually we would just get from the same manufacturer, okay, unless you just want to add one or two, right? Other than that, you get everything from the same manufacturer, so you that so from there you can actually see the table, what are the modules available. You can list it out, okay? Then from there, now what you need to do is you check this total, okay? So this total is 125, okay, 125 digital output at 230 watt that you need, okay? So from here you can estimate how many numbers of modules of this 16 digital output 230 watt that you require, okay? So here they suggest 8, okay? You just check whether 16 times 8 whether it's correct or not. 128, okay? If this is correct, okay, it's more than this number, then you have extra three port or three slot for your future usage, okay? So this is how you can double check. So again, if you are the client side, okay, then your design company, okay, they provide you with this list, okay, for you to approve later on, okay? They may propose doing this and so on. So this is how you can actually check, okay, how many empty IO that they have, okay, for you to expand in the future, okay, to add extra buttons and so on, okay? Then also you have you can also check for the digital input 240, okay, require is 106, okay? Then the module that we are using is 16 digital input, okay? So 16, so this number you divide by 16, you can roughly estimate that you need 7 of it, okay? 7 of this, then that will give you about 112, okay? So more than this, then that's great, okay? And you have extra 6 empty slot, okay, for you to expand, okay? So this is how you can actually design for your IO system. The last part would be to address all this IO, okay, through the address, okay, in your program, okay. The address of this IO are generally quite straightforward, okay, in the memory itself, okay. So if you're dealing with PLC or microprocessor, okay, then this all this address concept are very similar. You just have to point to the correct part of your address in the memory, then you can grab the information from it, okay? So every single digital input and output, they also have this kind of so-called address, okay, being specified by the IO module. So when you apply a PLC itself, okay, so you have all this numbering, okay, on top of it, okay. And also you may also remember you have the input have maybe a group of 4, okay, then you may have 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, okay, for group number 1, okay. Then from group number 2 you may have 2.1, 2.2, 2.3, okay. So that would be the easy way to visualize it, okay, so that in the PLC itself, okay, you still can do all this referring address or unique number, okay, then the PLC will do the conversions to the direct address, okay, to locate it from the memory itself, okay. So every PLC manufacturer actually use their own addressing system, okay? They may have usually is 8 number, okay, 1 to 8, okay, for the first group, then second group, and so on, okay. This would be, we call it as a decimal system. Then octal system is from 0 to 7, okay, they count 0 as 1 and so on, right? So it depends on which manufacturer you are using, you just refer to their menu, right? So if you want to modify, you just refer to the menu, okay? Then the main thing would be the input output naming, okay? So you may also, depends on the manufacturer, they may use X, use I, use E for the input, okay? For input, usually they use I, okay? Then for the output, then they will have Y, O, Q, okay? Generally, they use Q, right? Because to avoid O looks like zero, okay? So it depends which they prefer, right? Then to address they may also sometimes just use this kind of digit, okay, 4-digit, okay, instead of I, O, and so on, okay? So very dependent on the manufacturer, okay, the device that you're going to use, right? The memory will be stored in the byte structures, okay? As you can see, the first group would be the input, okay? Then the second digit would be the bit of the, you can see the bit of this so-called memory mapping, right? So you can have like the first group itself, or yeah, for the second group, okay, represent by the bit number 2, okay, a bit number 5, okay, byte number 2. So you may have input I 2.5, okay, so you have this marking on your PLC actually, right? So you just have to refer to that particular port that you are connected to, then should be fine, right? So that is where you can do the addressing of it, okay? That would be helpful for you in the programming in the later stage, right? So that's all for today, okay? Any questions before we end the sessions? Let's see. In practical, mechanical is the one to do PLC design or EE design. Okay, so for these questions, actually, when we really come to work in the industry, they don't care whether you have a mechanical degree or electrical degree. Okay, as long as you can do the work, they will give you the work. Okay, so for sure, when at different level of a role, okay, you may somehow encounter, in the sense that from the mechanical standpoint, okay, you may deal with the hardware side, okay, the machines and so on. And on the machine side, okay, you may also want to suggest, okay, the more you know, then the better that you can suggest, so that the integrations will be better, okay? And at the end of the day, if you are getting promoted to managers and so on, okay, then your role change, okay? And the role doesn't specify that you need electrical or mechanical or what, okay? They assume that you can actually oversee all these operations, okay, from electrical to mechanical or whatever it is. So the more you know, then it would be a plus point for you to, so that whatever people say, you have your own knowledge to justify, okay? You don't need to depend on other people to actually do all this justification for you, all right? So any more questions? So if no more questions, then we will call this session to an end. Then we will meet again 2 weeks later, right after the mid-sem break, right? Okay, see you. Stay safe. Bye-bye.